So why don't we start with you, John? And if you could maybe, I always feel like artists do a better job of sort of giving their bios than introducers reading, you know, the bio page from an artist website. So I'm gonna
just use the Wikipedia entry.
Yeah,
it's all true.
I guess maybe if you could give us a just sort of a abbreviated version of your professional biography by way of artists you've worked with.
Oh sure. Are we gonna? Can you hear me?
Yes.
You can hear me.
Yes.
I'm John Sanborn. I've been doing this for over 40 years. I discovered video art in France at a exhibition that was probably the first full-fledged museum showcase of video art in 1974 in Paris. And I got to meet, because it was early days, I got to meet a lot of the original artists who had really done extraordinary work in video, including Namjoon Paik, who ended up becoming my sort of personal video master. If you don't know his work, please hit Wikipedia and find what you can on YouTube. His guidance has stayed with me for many years. He was my friend, he was my mentor, and we did a lot of really nutso things together. Over the years, I found collaboration to be incredibly fruitful. Every collaboration is different. I did some collaborative work with Namjoon, most specifically a satellite broadcast that he did called Good Morning, Mr. Orwell, in which I created a number of works for the show. He actually insisted on using one of my pieces to open the show. Through the years, I've collaborated with a lot of composers and choreographers, Melissa Fenby, Bill T. Jones, Twyla Tharp, Robert Ashley, Philip Glass, but every collaboration is different. And while they're all very different, there's one element that has to be in place, which is trust. You're gonna do something that you would not do by yourself, and you're gonna share a lot of intimate and exposed conversation with someone who you have to trust. And when that trust is established, the give and take becomes fairly fluid and fairly seamless. People always ask me, oh, what did you do and what did so-and-so do? Well, it's not really that simple. Because when the trust is very strong and you are in a place you would not normally go to, which is why you collaborate in the first place, there are many times where a gesture, a glance, a conversation spawns something truly unique and truly different for you. And then the result is a work that bears the marks of both, or all of the collaborators, because you can collaborate with multiple people at the same time.
That's a good place to start. Maybe we could then segue into a clip of one of the...
Have Monet introduce herself to
us. Oh, of course.
Please.
Can you hear me, or should I use the mic? Mic? Yeah, I have a soft voice. It's Monet Clark, you know that. And I got into video art in around 92. I started my art making practice as a photographer. And I always had a camera. background. You know, people ask that when we talk about ritual or something, but I just think it's valid to do ritual no matter what race you are. And we live in a melting pot culture where we get a lot of influences. But anyway, back to video, I got a scholarship to go to the San Francisco Art Institute. I was photographing friends of mine in the punk scene who were transitioning into motherhood and these binaries of tough and non-nurturing and just completely ill-prepared to be nurturing and mothering was really fascinating to me. And so I early on got into binaries as a kind of a way to stretch, which I think happened a lot in now with John and I. I found my way to the performance video department, fell in love with the medium, found my performing side. I'm typically a fairly shy person, so I like the intimacy of putting a camera on a tripod and working. And it served me very well because it's, you know, you bring things out that you wouldn't do in front of everybody else, probably. I mean, maybe some people would, but, and then you have a record of these performances, right? I have all these pieces from the early 90s, so I got really into it, and I would say that's my main medium, and I had a bit of success in the early 90s, showed internationally, and then I got very ill with a neuroimmune illness, and I spent 12 harrowing years fighting for my life. I used a lot of the healing practices and spiritual practices that I had been steeped in growing up. I had also minored in holistic health, I should say that. In San Francisco State, which is a lot about mind-body medicine, and it was very groundbreaking at the time. And so I made work that was performative, where I did a lot of self-portraiture through my illness. I'm with an emaciated body, very, very sick, and juxtaposed those 8 years later when I was better and referencing the politics of my particular health condition, which affects mostly women and is not validated medically. Now it is, but it wasn't at the time. How we marginalize the feminine voice, how natural medicine is what helped me get better, which is really political, actually. So, you know, the personal is political, has come, you know, through my work. And then as I got better, I started to make a whole new series of performance video works that were very glamorous and talking a lot about objectification of the female form and sexual stereotypes and playing with, they're very humorous. I always work with humor, not always, but typically in my performance video pieces. And just have kept going full speed ahead with my performance video work. So I got better in 2009, started, 2007, and then started showing again in 2009. And it's just slow, gradually, the last 9 years, I've kind of climbed my way back. So now for me is a juxtaposition of the years of study of non-Western healing modalities and my feminist performance video practice. And I see this amazing turning point happening right now, culturally, where we're not shunning things, which to me are the shunning of things, these biases culturally are just like a symptom of the suppression of the feminine principle, which is just the last thing I want to say about it. It's non-essentialist, so men have it, women have it, we all have a feminine side, a masculine side, and it's really more about principles and elements than how we dress or something, right? Like wear a dress or pants. So anyway, that's a little of how it all came about, and and then camera works. Work with this guy, and I was like, okay, let's try it out. It's like a really crazy process, and I'm really happy with what we made. So.
I think one of the things that actually we had very much in common was a sense of humor. And the fact that we would do serious things but not necessarily take them very seriously. And finding different ways to inject humor, comedy, and a sense of wit into the work that we were doing, both separately and then obviously now, was something that really joined us together. Just this idea that the first words you hear in this very somber setting is, "Wake the fuck up!" just made me very happy. You want to show some bunny girl?
Yeah.
Let's show some bunny girl. Let's show bunny girl. I mean, you just did a thing, so. And I like bunny girl. I think bunny girl's. Well, I saw the show that Monet did at Crowswork, where she showed this piece, and at first I was like, what? And part of my signing up for doing this project was I'm resigning from the patriarchy. I really don't like it, I don't want to be in it, I just want to get out. And so I'm looking for all these ways to circumvent the logic of the patriarchy. I thought Bunny Girl was a great subversive work, and particularly the idea of this pilgrim's process where she just gets more deranged but more enlightened as she crawls across this landscape. Really, it made me smile. And I think I asked you one point, do people know that this is funny?
You asked me, do you know it's funny?
You know it's funny? And she was like, yeah, of course, you idiot.
Would you set this up for us, Monique?
So I just want to show the opening scene to give you a sense of the comic timing, and then I'm going to show you a few stills of the piece. It's a 30-minute, 29-minute performance video movie. I had moved from LA back to Northern California and started using a 40-acre piece of property I was living on as my studio. And I did a series of performances, I call them performances for still camera. I would dress in my LA high fashion clothes and do things like pick berries and harvest acorns and stuff like that. Run a tractor, and I thought this was amusing. And I somehow got in my head I wanted a Playboy Bunny outfit. I commissioned someone to make it. They made it all wrong. It didn't fit my bust. The ears flopped down. I was totally like depressed for like 2 days, like literally just like, why did I move back to the country? Nobody can do anything up here, they can't function. And then it hit me and I'm like, what's wrong with me? This is a great outfit, I'm gonna use it. It's like, I'm just gonna put it on and run around and see what happens, which is exactly what I did. And then I enlisted my boyfriend, who was newly dating me at the time, who's also an artist, Jared Johnson. He helped assist us on our shoots, and I said, here's the camera, just shoot me, I'm gonna get out on the side of the road. And he's like, what the fuck? So we just started shooting, so that's the first scene you're gonna see, and then we went on location to different places, and it evolved, and I started getting a sense of what I was doing, but it was very, very non-linear, which is usually how I work. It's not how I worked it now. But I had no idea what I was making until the end, and I'll show you a still at the end. It's the only place.